Hi, I'm Philip, and this is Aeon Timeline. Aeon Timeline is a flexible software application for creating, visualizing, and understanding timelines. Timelines are a great way to plan stories, manage projects, document chronologies, and conduct research. This video will introduce the basics of using Aeon Timeline, and keep an eye out for future videos that will cover additional workflows and features that might be especially useful for your particular project or profession. Aeon Timeline offers a fully featured free trial and is available for Windows and Mac OS. So check out the links below to download the app and follow along with this introduction. So let's get started. In this tutorial, we're going to start a timeline from scratch. So we'll click the new timeline button in the top left. Rather than focus on a particular type of project today, we're going to keep things general. So we are going to use the general template by clicking here. This general template is a bare bones template that lets you model events, people, and locations as shown here. Click next to confirm. This next screen is asking us how we want our timeline to record and display time. A timeline that uses regular dates has events that start at particular times as you would see on a calendar, such as March 2012, or 11 a.m. on July 1st of 2008. Timelines that use one of these last three options don't record the time using exact calendar dates, but rather record time using general units, such as week 2 or day 12 or hour 33. Let's stick with regular dates and click Use this template. We've now created a new file and are being shown the timeline view. Over to the left is our sidebar. It's currently showing the tutorial panel. We probably don't need a tutorial inside our tutorial, so let's click this icon here to close it. To kick things off, let's create a new event by double-clicking in the timeline. We can then immediately start typing to name our event. Hit enter to confirm. As you can see, our event has a date and time based on where I clicked. To change this date and time, you can click, hold, and drag on the event in the timeline to reposition it and to change the time based on where you dropped the event. If you want to specify a very precise time, we can go over here to the right to the inspector. In the start field, you can click and then edit the text here to update the time to be whatever you would like. While we're here, it's worth noting that our event has both a start time and an end time, and that they are currently the same. This means that our event ends as soon as it starts, hence the duration of 0 seconds. To give our event a duration, we can go back to the timeline view, click, hold, and drag on the left side of the diamond to stretch it out and to give it a duration. We can do this same thing by click, holding, and dragging on the right side as well. Again, if we wanted to be very precise, we could go back to the inspector to the end date field and edit the text there. We can also specify or modify the end date by changing the duration field directly. This is useful when planning events or using events to plan projects, where you might know how long something should take, but aren't tied to any particular end date. It's also worth noting that there are lots of ways to create events in Aeon Timeline. You can create events in the other views. If you have lots of data in a spreadsheet that you'd like to transfer into Aeon Timeline, we have a flexible CSV importer that you can access from the file menu. You can also synchronize Aeon Timeline with Scrivener and Ulysses to import data from existing writing projects. Now, let's quickly create a few more events in the canvas. With a few events in place, we can look at how to navigate the timeline view. On a trackpad, you can scroll to the left or to the right using the standard two-finger swipe gesture. If you are using a mouse, you can scroll to the left or right by holding the mouse wheel button and dragging the mouse to the left or right. There is also a mini map of your timeline that runs along the bottom. This is especially useful for navigating large timelines, as you can click anywhere on the mini map to jump between different positions. You can also click, hold, and drag the square to change what you're seeing more precisely. To control the time scale of the timeline, you can use the pinch gesture on a trackpad, or hold down either Control or Command and scroll your mouse wheel. Note that as we pinch in or scroll up, we make the time scale greater, so we begin to see our divisions shift from days into months and eventually into years. And as we pinch out or scroll down, we see smaller and smaller time scales, and our events become more spread out. This slider down the bottom can change the time scale in a more precise manner or configure its upper and lower limits. Now, let's move on to organizing our events. Aeon Timeline gives you many options for categorizing your information. Today, we will look at two simple options, assigning colors and assigning parents. Assigning a new color is pretty simple. Just select the item, go to the inspector on the right, and then in this drop-down, you can select a new color option. What these colors mean is up to you, but you can customize your colors and their labels in the settings area. To do so, click the cog icon in the top right, and then go to the colors tab. I'm going to select the color I just assigned and give it a new label. Now, let's look at assigning parents. To do so, click an event, go back to the inspector, and in the parent field, select another event to assign it as a parent. Our event has now been hidden under our parent, and you can see that there's an arrow here to the right of the parent showing that it has hidden events. Click that arrow to reveal the event. Grouping events using parents is super useful for organizing complex timelines and hiding events when you don't want to see them. It's also useful for organizing events that are highly related. If you are planning a project, you might group together events that represent subtasks. If you're planning a story or doing research, you might group together events that all take place during one particularly long journey, festival, or campaign. Up until now, we've been creating events that are shown in the timeline. But Aeon Timeline lets you create different types of data, not just events. Sometimes a particular type of data might appear in the timeline alongside or in place of events. For example, in a project management context, you might have projects and tasks as types of data that live alongside events. In a creative writing context, you might have backstories or flashbacks as types of data that distinguish themselves from regular events. You can also have types of data that don't appear in the timeline, but help contextualize the events of your timeline. For example, our general template provided us with a location type and a people type. To create people, we can click this icon to open up the sidebar panel for people, and then click and type in this field to quickly create new people. Once created, we can click a person to view their details in the inspector, as we did with our events. We can change colors, assign parents, and also assign dates. Even though our people aren't shown in the timeline, these dates are still useful for tracking a number of things. In the context of fiction, you might be tracking when a character was born and when they died. Whereas in a project management context, you might use these dates to track when people are available or unavailable to work. Now, what's really powerful is when you begin to relate your different types of data. This would allow you to say certain people were present during an event, or to assign people to particular projects or tasks, amongst many other kinds of uses. to create these kinds of relations between different types of data, you can create a relationship. That relationship could be between two people, or between a person and an event, or between two events. Relationships can be specific, or they can be general. A specific relationship might be a person being a witness to an event, or one person being the manager or the neighbor of another person. Whereas a generic relationship lets you connect two things together without needing to classify what that connection is just yet. Different types of relationship are available in each template or can be configured. For now, we are going to use a generic type of relationship that came with our generic template. To create a relationship, we can navigate to a new tab in the inspector, this one with the person icon. So with the person selected, I'm going to create a relationship to an event by clicking the Add Relationship button, scrolling down to Event, and clicking Relates To, and then selecting my event. I could also do this by clicking an event, going to that same relationship tab, clicking more relationships, going down to people, and then selecting relates to, and then clicking the person. When I do so, I can see my relationship from both sides. I can see that this event is related to Jake, and I'm seeing it in Jake's panel here. Or if I click the event, I can see the same relationship here as well. However, we can also configure the timeline view itself to show these relationships amongst many other kinds of data. To do so, we can click this icon here in the lower left, go to the relationships section, and click person. We can now see these icons with the initials J and P that refer to Philip and Jake, showing our events' relationships to these people. We can also turn on other types of data, such as a report of the duration of our events that have a duration. So far, we've been working in the timeline view, but our app offers other types of views that let you create, edit, and visualize your data in a different way. Data is shared between views, so you can pick and choose which view works best for your immediate needs and general workflow. In this tutorial, we will also quickly introduce the spreadsheet view, so let's click to go there. This view shows us the same data that was in our timeline, but organizes it in a tabular form that makes it easy to see all of our events and make edits to them. The spreadsheet view also offers a quick way to add new events by typing in the bottom row. When you create an event this way, it doesn't have a start date or an end date, and so it won't show up in the timeline. This can be useful if you have an idea for an event, but aren't sure exactly when it takes place. When you do want to give your event a date, you can click and type in any of the date fields. You can also select one of the date fields and use this calendar picker icon to change the date that way. Note that our date only has a day of the month, a month, and a year at the moment. If we go back to the calendar picker, we can see why its precision is currently set to only be at the level of a day. This could instead be at the level of a year or a month, or if we also wanted to give our event a time of day, we can change it to time and then enter in a time value. As in the timeline view, we can customize what the spreadsheet view shows us. To do so, we use the same icon in the lower left. Here, I might turn off the color and type fields, but might turn on my relationships so I can see the ones that I added earlier, and also turn on the summary field. The summary field is another property of different types of data, be it a person or an event, that we can edit. To select an entire event, rather than just one of its data fields, we use this column in the far left. And we then see the inspector as we did in the timeline. While we're here, let's look at the last two tabs of the inspector. The properties tab with the chat bubble icon shows us the summary fields, the tag fields, and any custom properties that were defined by our template or configured by us in settings. So we can see the summary that we entered earlier. The last tab, the attachments tab with the paperclip icon, allows us to associate images, files, and links with an event. I'm going to link to an image and paste a URL from my clipboard here to show it in line. So that was a quick walkthrough of Aeon Timeline, focusing on the timeline view and the spreadsheet view. When you've finished exploring and developing the file that we made with the general template, I'd encourage you to head back here to the welcome screen by selecting New from the File menu. If you'd like to start a new project, you can select one of these first four tiles, which will create a new file with some example content and some more specific types of relationships and data types that are tailored to each of these use cases here. You could also select one of these last four tiles to get a sense of the app's possibilities, as each tile will open a file with a built-out timeline that showcases additional features for classifying and visualizing data. In future videos, we will cover using other views beyond the timeline and spreadsheet views, as well as explore more advanced features and highlight workflows that are relevant to particular kinds of projects and professions. In the meantime, thanks for watching.